Hello everyone, this is Dr. Resham Basani, your educator in the subject of dermatology on an academy. To introduce myself, I have done my MD from the Grand Medical College, Mumbai, and I am currently practicing dermatologist at Matunga. I am also associated with the Wadia Group of Hospitals, and I was associated as faculty as an assistant professor for 10 years at KJ Somaiya Medical College before I joined an academy. So with that introduction, I would want you to know about the plus subscription of an academy. The plus subscription of an academy gives you access to the daily live classes, structured courses, live tests, quizzes, as well as an unlimited access to all the an academy content. Okay, so it includes all the live lectures as well as the previously recorded lectures. Also, you should know about the iconic subscription. So this iconic subscription is where you get the best of an academy and the best of prep ladder. Through an academy, you get the live classes, live tests and quizzes, while through prep ladder, you get the video lectures, question banks, as well as rapid revision courses. So for this, what you need to do is to download the an academy learning app. This app is available on your iOS and on your Android platforms. And what you need to do is that you can opt for either the plus subscription or you can opt for the iconic subscription. If you opt for the plus subscription, it would cost you around 2063 a month for a period of 12 months. And if you opt for the iconic subscription, it would cost you around 4125 a month for a period of 12 months. But if you use the code MENTOR, that is MENTOR, if you use the code MENTOR, it will give you an additional 10% off. With that, I would like you to know about all the upcoming batches for the INICET. There is an operation batch course which has started off on 8th of March. There is a focus batch course for FMGE 2021, which has again started off on 8th of March. Further, so these are the two courses that you need to be aware of. Now let's move on to our MCQs. So I'll be reading out the MCQs, and I would want you to give me the correct answer in the chat box. Okay, so you have a 3-year-old female child who presents to the office with fever and rash for 3 days. The rash is maculopapular that first appeared in the head and now has involved the trunk. The child also has cough and also has a red eye. She is not up to date with her vaccination schedule. There is no similar history in the family members. On examination, the temperature is 101, the pulse is 112, and the respiratory rate is 26. Both the eyes are red without any discharge. There is a bluish white spot in the buccal mucosa. Chest auscultation is normal. PCR reveals a single-stranded RNA virus. So the question is, what medication could decrease the morbidity and mortality in patients with this condition? So first I would like to ask you, what do you think is the condition that we are looking at? You have a 3-year-old female who is not optimally vaccinated and she is presenting to you with a maculopapular rash which started on the head and the retroauricular area, and now she also has and then progress to involve the entire body. As you can see in the picture, she also has red eyes and she also has cough, mild cough. So can you please tell me, what do you think is the condition that we are looking at in this particular MCQ? First, just tell me, what is your diagnosis on the basis of the scenario that is provided to you? Anyone? They have also told you that PCR is showing a single-stranded RNA virus and there is a blue spot in the buccal mucosa. So can someone tell me, what is the diagnosis? Anyone, come on. quick quick so that I can move ahead. No, Firoz, it's not vitamin C. The correct answer is vitamin A. The diagnosis in this patient is measles. Okay, so measles, basically, what are the features of measles? First of all, it tends to appear in children. Okay, and she's not optimized, she's not optimally vaccinated. So, possibly she's not received the measles vaccine. So, initially, there is fever, then there is a rash. Rash in measles would usually appear at the fourth day of fever. Prior to the appearance, the patient can have an erythema in the form of a Koplik spots. Okay, so the Koplik spot is a bluish white spot in the buccal mucosa opposite the first molar. Okay, and after that, there is a rash which starts off in the retroauricular area and over the forehead, and then it spreads in a cephalocaudal fashion. This particular rash is usually maculopapular, and then once start then the rash starts resolving, and when it starts resolving, it also resolves in the same fashion as it came. And after the rash resolves, you typically see a kind of desquamation, and it leads to brownish discoloration. Okay, so this picture that is provided to you, as well as the complete clinical scenario, points towards a diagnosis of measles. Okay, and measles, you remember the medication that would decrease the mortality and the morbidity of the patient in this condition is vitamin A. Okay? The child with maculopapular rash, cough, conjunctivitis, Koplik spots, and PCR finding is most suggestive of measles. There is no specific antiviral therapy for measles. The treatment is primarily supportive: control of fever, prevention and correction of dehydration, and infection control measures, including appropriate isolation, form the mainstay of therapy. Vitamin A should be given to prevent morbidity and mortality in a patient with measles. High fever, conjunctivitis, and cough can be present for several days. Isolate adults or pediatric patients that present with rash and fever immediately, and airborne precautions need to be recommended. Okay, so this is something that you need to remember. If you have a patient of measles, please give the patient vitamin A to prevent morbidity and mortality. Now let's go to the next question. Now there is a 35-year-old female who presents to the dermatological clinic for a follow-up. She has severe cystic acne during her teenage years, which has mostly resolved except during her menstrual cycle. She is complaining of post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation on her cheeks bilaterally. She has tried hydroquinone with minimal improvement. She heard about a combination cream that can be effective and wants to know more about it. What medications make up this cream? Hydroquinone is the only option. Hydroquinone and fluocinolone, hydroquinone and tretinoin, or hydroquinone, tretinoin, and fluocinolone. These are the four options given to you. I would want you to answer. What do you think is the correct answer? Anyone? Firoz? So basically, she wants to know about a combination cream that is more effective than just 4% hydroquinone. Okay, so the combination cream that she is talking about is the triple combination of Kligman, okay, or the Kligman's formula. The Kligman's formula typically includes three components. It includes hydroquinone, tretinoin, and fluocinolone. Now let me tell you what is the logic of combining these three medications. Now hydroquinone is a tyrosinase inhibitor, right? So it's going to decrease the synthesis of melanin, okay, from the melanocytes. So hence it is a gold standard bleaching agent, right? Now when you add tretinoin with it, what does tretinoin do? Tretinoin is going to increase the exfoliation of the skin, so it will get rid of the pigmented melanocytes, right? So tretinoin is used as a combination with hydroquinone, but this combination of tretinoin and hydroquinone can be very irritating to the skin. So there can be flaking, there can be redness, and hence to neutralize the irritant potential of hydroquinone and tretinoin, you add on fluocinolone. Okay, so this is the logic behind using the Kligman's regimen for the treatment of pigmentary disorders. Okay, so usually the Kligman's regimen becomes the first line treatment for hyperpigmentation that includes conditions like melasma. But what you need to be aware of, that this combination you cannot keep on applying for a long time. The reason being that hydroquinone, when you abuse it, when you use it for a very long time, and especially when you use a higher concentration of hydroquinone to the tune of 4% and above, then you have a higher chance of developing something called as ochronosis. Okay, so exogenous ochronosis can occur because of use of hydroquinone. Second thing is fluocinolone is a topical steroid. Topical steroids are not indicated for the use on the face for a prolonged period, because you know the topical steroid can cause thinning of the skin, it can cause hypopigmentation, it can cause acne and acneiform eruptions, it can also lead to telangiectasias and can cause atrophy of the skin. So also abuse of these topical steroid containing creams on the skin can lead to steroid induced rosacea as well as a topical steroid damaged face, as a result of which the patient will become dependent on the skin lightening cream and will develop symptoms and a rebound flare of rosacea and acne when the creams are not used. So whenever you prescribe a triple combination cream for the treatment of hyperpigmentation, there has to be a lot of counseling that goes along with it. You have to ensure that the patient does not apply the cream for beyond 6 weeks, and it has to be only under medical supervision. You have to tell the patient that we are giving you this cream so that your pigmentation improves, but this is not something that you are going to use forever. It is a medication which can have its own set of side effects. So you have to tell the patient what side effects can occur, and then you have to write the prescription. Okay, so that was about this question. Now let's go to the next question. Okay, I want you to answer. 28-year-old female presents for treatment of acne scars with dermabrasion. 2 months ago, she finished a 6-month course of a medication that significantly improved her nodulocystic acne, made her lips very dry, and required monthly pregnancy testing. What is the drug she received? Did she receive spironolactone, ciprotron acetate, isotretinoin, or methotrexate is the question. I would want someone to answer this. This is relatively easy. Anyone? 28-year-old female, now she comes with acne scars, but earlier she had a lot of nodulocystic acne, and the medication which was given to her for nodulocystic acne made her skin quite dry, lips became very dry, and she required monthly pregnancy testing. So what was the drug that she received? Anyone?
Thank you.
help me move ahead. Come on, someone answer. It's not very. What is the drug of choice for nodular cystic acne? Okay, so the drug of choice for nodular cystic acne is isotretinoin. Isotretinoin is a drug which is teratogenic. Okay, so because this drug is teratogenic, as a mandate, the patient needs to get pregnancy testing done. Apart from that, you need to, that is one drug which is going to be causing dryness of the lips. Skylitis or lip dryness is the most common side effect of oral isotretinoin. The reason why you give oral isotretinoin in nodular cystic acne is that one, isotretinoin is the only medication which decreases the size of the sebaceous gland. Okay, so it will decrease the excessive seborrhea. Second thing, it declogs the gland. Okay, so it is going to cause, it's going to cause a declogging of the gland, as a result of which you will see that there will be reduction in the acne. But because of the same reason, once you start isotretinoin, you may notice that there is slight flare of acne. Apart from that, this is the drug which is going to act on the Propionibacterium acnes, and it is going to decrease the inflammatory component of acne. So because of all these reasons, isotretinoin becomes one of the drugs of choice for nodular cystic acne. But as I said, it is teratogenic, so one should be ensuring that when the patient is on isotretinoin, you have to ensure that she undergoes monthly pregnancy testing. Also, you should counsel the patient to avoid pregnancy by utilizing at least two modalities of contraception. And one should ensure that the patient does not conceive even after 1 month after the isotretinoin is stopped. Okay. Now let's go to this next question. We have around 12 minutes more. You have a patient who presents with a rash over the trunk that is large and irregular. There are several annular lesions with papillovesicular borders and central hypopigmentation. A Wood's lamp examination shows yellow fluorescence. Skin scrapings treated with potassium hydroxide show the spaghetti and meatballs, which is consistent with the Malassezia furfur infection. Which layer of the skin would show the organisms is the question. Would you use... Where do you see it? Do you see it in the stratum corneum, in the dermis, in the stratum spinosum, or the hypodermis? Can someone tell me the answer? Firoz says it's 3. Anyone else? Anyone else come up with the right answer? No, Amit Dhama also says 3. No, that's unfortunately the wrong answer. See, what is the condition? First tell me, what is the condition that you are looking at? What is the condition that we are dealing with in this patient? Which condition is going to show you spaghetti meatballs, which is a Malassezia furfur infection of the skin? What is it called? Yes, Firoz, you are right. The condition that we are dealing with is basically pitreasis versicolor. Pitreasis versicolor is a condition which is caused by Malassezia furfur. Okay, and this Malassezia furfur, it tends to reside in the stratum corneum. Okay, it is a keratinophilic organism. It tends to reside in the stratum corneum. Okay, so the correct answer is A. Now, pitreasis versicolor, pityriasis means scaly. Okay, and why? What are the kind of scales that you see in pitreasis versicolor? The scales of Pityriasis versicolor are briny, powdery, furfuraceous scales, and versicolor means it is variously colored. Okay, that is why it is called as versicolor. It can be brown, it can be white, it can be pink. Okay, so basically this condition is caused by Malassezia yeasts. The Malassezia yeasts are the normal inhabitants of the skin, especially of the seborrheic areas. And what actually happens is that whenever it gets a conducive condition, like for example, in people who tend to sweat a lot, in people who have an excessively oily skin, in people who do not have good hygiene, like they don't have a bath daily. In such individuals, what happens is because it gets a good environment, it tends to multiply. Okay, and the multiplication happens maximally in the perifollicular areas, because you know that the sebaceous gland, it opens out into the hair follicle. So when the sebaceous gland opens out into the hair follicle, the maximum oil is going to be around the perifollicular area, right? So because this maximally colonizes in the perifollicular areas, when you get Pityriasis versicolor, you start off with lesions in the perifollicular area which tend to then coalesce together, and then you have multiple patches, and these patches are going to have a typical scalloped border. Okay, so basically this particular problem happens when there is a shift in the balance between the host and the normal flora, which allows the proliferation of the fungus. The most commonly associated Malassezia include Malassezia globosa, Sympodialis, and Furfur. Upper trunk is the most common site for Pityriasis versicolor. So, Pityriasis versicolor can be hypopigmented, it can be hyperpigmented, right? So, hypopigmented Pityriasis versicolor, as you can see in the picture, it starts off as fine, briny, powdery scales. Itching is unusual. Hypopigmentation is occurring because of the azelaic acid, which is secreted by the Malassezia species, that inhibits the tyrosinase in the melanin production pathway. And this hypopigmentation occurs because of a direct cytotoxic effect on the melanocytes. Now, this is hyperpigmented variant of Pityriasis versicolor. The hyperpigmentation occurs because of the large or the giant melanosomes. Always remember that there is a scratch sign or Cope de Onglet sign or nail sign or the Besnier sign that is seen in Pityriasis versicolor. So what does it say? The scratch sign says that in a patient with Pityriasis versicolor, because the the scales are very fine, so as to make the scales prominent, what you can do is to scratch the lesion of Pityriasis versicolor firmly, and that will make the scales more evident. So there are multiple names for this sign. It's called as the scratch sign, Cope de Onglet sign, also called as the Besnier sign or the nail sign. When you do a Wood's lamp examination, you will see the presence of pale yellow fluorescence. Now this pale yellow fluorescence that you see in Pityriasis versicolor is because of the secretion of pitriolactone and pteridine, which is secreted by the fungus. Okay, so this is the reason for fluorescence. Okay, so Wood's lamp examination, remember, will show you a pale yellow fluorescence. And when you do a KOH mount, this KOH mount will show you the spiggety meatball or the banana and grapes appearance. So basically the grapes are the variously sized spores, okay, or they are also called as meatballs. Okay, remember, culture is not something that is going to be very useful in the diagnosis of Pityriasis versicolor, because this particular organism is a normal commensal of the skin. So even if you do find it positive on culture, it does not mean that it is pathogenic. Okay, now as regards the treatment of Pityriasis versicolor, the first line treatment is usually with topicals. So you can use topical azoles like clotrimazole, you can use ketoconazole, okay, oxyconazole, okay. So these are the topical azoles. You can also give topical terbinafine. Remember, topical terbinafine is used in the treatment of Pityriasis versicolor, but oral terbinafine does not work for Pityriasis versicolor. This is something that you need to remember. Okay, so topical terbinafine works, oral terbinafine does not work. You can also combine the azole with selenium sulfide. The only hitch behind using topical selenium sulfide is sometimes that it can have an irritation potential. Now, if you do not respond to the first line treatment, okay, then you can go in for the second line treatment. So, in the second line treatment, you combine the topical treatment with an oral medication. The oral medication that you could give is oral fluconazole. It is given in a dose of 400 milligrams single dose and you repeat it after 15 days. You can also give oral itraconazole in the dose of 100 milligrams two times in a day for up to a week. And oral ketoconazole can be given, but it is no longer preferred because there is a high incidence of hepatotoxicity with this medication. Oral greasiofulvin also does not work for the treatment of pityriasis versicolor. Amit Dhama, what have you been asking me about the nail paint? Nail lacquer, you mean? The nail lacquer is used in the treatment of onychomycosis. Onychomycosis is a condition where you have dermatophytic infection of the nail plate. Okay, so in that condition, you can use a topical nail lacquer. Okay, it's not a nail paint, it's called as a nail lacquer. The contents of the lacquer can be topical amorphine or it can be topical cyclopyroxolamine. If you are using topical amorphine nail lacquer, you need to use it once or twice in a week. If you are using cyclopyroxolamine, you can use it every day. Okay, so it has to be applied, and first, before you apply the nail lacquer, you have to scrape off the nail and then you have to apply it as you would apply a nail paint. Okay, and before your next application, ensure that you scrape off the previous application and then you apply the second application. Okay, so that nail lacquer is for onychomycosis of the nail. It is not meant for pityriasis versicolor. Okay, so I think that's the time we have today. Do you have any questions in dermatology? You can let me know. Any questions, anyone? We were discussing about the fluorescence which we saw in patients with pityriasis versicolor. We saw that there was pale yellow fluorescence in pityriasis versicolor. Can someone tell me what is the condition in which you get coral red fluorescence? Where do you get coral red fluorescence? Which condition which can mimic pityriasis versicolor, which can happen in the axilla, do you get a coral red fluorescence? Anyone? Come on, Amit, Firoz, Smart, Pino, anyone here, please do reply. Anyone? Where do you get coral red fluorescence? Okay, I'll reply for you. Coral red fluorescence is seen in erythrasma. Erythrasma is a condition which is caused by the organism Cornibacteria. Cornibacteria minutissimum. Okay, and it mimics this particular infection. It tends to occur in the axilla, tends to occur in the toe web spaces, can occur in the inframammary areas, and it tends to mimic pityriasis versicolor. So sometimes you need to differentiate the two, and the best way to differentiate them is by using a Wood's lamp, because a Wood's lamp will show you pale yellow fluorescence in pityriasis versicolor, while it will show you a typical coral red fluorescence in patients with erythrasma. The treatment of both these conditions is going to vary. In erythrasma, your treatment will be with topical antibiotics like topical clindamycin. You can give oral erythromycin. While for pityriasis versicolor, you need to give oral antifungals and topical antifungals. Okay, so that's the time we have today. Thank you very much for attending the class. We'll see you soon. Okay.